Can you all hear me? Yep. All right. So we're going to go ahead and get started. My name is Caitlin Cameron. I'm the urban designer for the city of Portland, and I'm the project manager for the Congress Square Redesign Project. We're all here because public art was a high priority in our visioning process when we were thinking about what Congress Square wants to become. And so we have this very rare and unique opportunity to design the public art and the space together at the same time, collaboratively. So for those of you who attended the May 4th forum with the design teams, this will be the same format, so but with the artists this time, the finalists we have for the Public Art Commission. So first we will hear from the four artists, so we'll give a 20-minute presentation each, and then we'll have some time for question and answer. And we also have these survey cards that were at the table up front. We'd very much like to hear from you. If you don't want to fill it out tonight, there's a link at the bottom that you can fill out online. You're also free to take a few of these and pass them out to folks, because we have CTN in the back of the room filming for us tonight, and we're going to post a link to the film of this evening for people to access as well. To give you a sense of the next steps of this process, once the artist is selected for the project, the design team and the artist will begin the concept designs for Congress Square. So be on the lookout for announcements of public events and meetings to do with developing those concepts, probably beginning in the fall and through the spring. With that, I'm going to introduce Pandora LaCase, who is one of the chairs of the Congress Square Art Selection Committee. Sorry, it's a lot of titles there. This is a subcommittee of the Public Art Committee tasked with selecting the artists for this project. So I'll hand it over to Pandora.
Good evening. Good evening. It's wonderful to see you all. Caitlin said a few things, but my name is Pandora LaCase. I co-chair the Congress Square Redesign Artist Selection Panel along with my colleague, Allison Hildreth. The selection panel is a subcommittee convened in 2014 by the Portland Public Art Committee to bring a signature work of art to Congress Square. On behalf of the Portland Public Arts Committee and the Artist Selection Panel, it is our great pleasure to introduce the finalists for the Congress Square Art Commission: Ned Kahn, Sarah Z, Patrick Merrill, and Matthew Ritchie. We would like to acknowledge and thank the members of the Artist Selection Panel for their many volunteer hours and valuable insights in order to get us to this exciting stage in the process. They are Ann Buckwalter, Artist Membership and Communications Manager at Space Gallery; Ian Jacob, Designer, Board Member and Representative of the Friends of Congress Square Park; Lynn Lisberger, Artist and Chair of the Portland Public Art Committee; and Jessica May, Chief Curator at the Portland Museum of Art; Tony Mensch, Landscape Architect and Member of the Portland Public Art Committee; Scott Simons, Architect and Founding Member of the Portland Society of Architects; Jessica Tomlinson, Director of Artists at Work at the Maine College of Art; Frank Turk, Artist and Board Member of the Friends of Congress Square Park; and Bruce Wennerstrom, former General Manager of the Westin Hotel. I would also like to thank our tireless leader, Caitlin Cameron, urban designer from Portland's Planning and Urban Development Department, who serves as the city liaison for the Portland Public Art Committee and is project manager for the Congress Square Redesign and Public Art Commission. Our goal was not to purchase a work of art that would be placed in the redesigned square. We chose to seize the rare opportunity of having artist and landscape designer work as equal partners from the beginning of the redesign process. These four talented artists here tonight demonstrate through their art and process the ability to work collaboratively with designers and community. And with that, I'd like to introduce our first artist, Ned Kahn.
Turn on. There it is. I'm going to show you like a half dozen videos of various completed projects, and I went through and kind of picked ones that seemed like maybe there were some parallels to the project here. And so The first one, if I can get it to work, is this is a park in downtown Pittsburgh that was an incredibly bleak, brutal urban space. It was built back in the 70s, and it had just turned into a ruin, and no one ever went in this place, and the city and the Pittsburgh Children's Museum raised a bunch of money to make it into, to kind of redo the whole thing, and they hired me, and they hired a landscape architect, a friend of mine named Andrea Cochran, and Andrea and I collaborated on the whole design of the park, and the original park was like this concrete pit going down to a water feature that had failed decades ago, and so we filled it all in, and we made the whole park into kind of a very accessible, a lot of trees, a lot of plants, and then I focused on kind of creating this kind of fog mist sort of water feature in the center of it, and it's basically a forest of these thin stainless steel poles, and there's little fog sprayers embedded into these poles, and the poles create this grid that's kind of like a cube, that kind of a like a suggestion of a architecture, but it's totally permeable. You can walk through it, and the fog nozzles are placed so that they create kind of a sphere of cloud inside this cube of these poles. And so the whole piece was intended as this thing that you would enter, and it creates a very different kind of microclimate when you go in there on a hot Pittsburgh day. The fog cools, but drops the temperature like 15 degrees in the space, and depending on the wind, sometimes it forms this perfect sphere, sometimes the wind blows it, sometimes it fills the whole park with kind of a low-hanging fog. And so a lot of my work is kind of sort of about nature, even though this is like a totally kind of man-made thing. It kind of, the actual artwork itself is kind of this cloud that responds to the wind and to the light and to whatever the atmosphere of the earth in that particular place is doing. This is a plaza at the Denver airport. Both Patrick and I worked on kind of parallel pieces at the airport. The existing terminal, they built a big new kind of hotel convention center complex, and then this was a big public space in between. And they actually ran into problems with the fire marshal. The space was too big, and the fire marshal said, you got to make half this plaza unoccupiable space. So I was the plan B. And so one of their plans before they got to me was to have a green roof. But when they got into it, like the weight of the soil and the fact that in the Denver climate, you know, your green roof is a brown roof for half the year. So I proposed this idea of this huge field that would be these counterweighted aluminum and plastic elements that would move in the wind and basically suggest grasses moving in the wind. But, you know, a field of grasses that you don't have to water or fertilize or worry about them turning brown. So like a lot of my work, it starts off as some maybe slightly poetic idea, but then it quickly turns into a manufacturing problem. Like, how do you, there are 18,500 of these elements that took us about 10 months to fabricate all the pieces and filled a couple, you know, huge trucks of all the pieces that drove it across from my studio in Northern California to Denver. And then like a month in the hot sun, I'm just tripping over these rocks here, assembling it all with my crew hating me more and more with each passing hour. And so there's a hotel right next to it. And so from all the windows of the hotel, on this side of the hotel, you look down on this field, and some of the most beautiful views are, you know, from the upper floors of this huge hotel. And sort of paradoxically, the farther away you get from the artwork, the more detailed it looks. It's like the individual moving pixels start to dissolve into a more kind of aqueous, liquid-like rendering of whatever the air currents are doing. And it's a super windy place in Denver. And And the light is always changing and the wind is always changing. And so you also see it from inside the terminal, and you can walk through the whole array. There's a large kind of pedestrian passageway that's actually one of the main connections between the new hotel convention center and the existing terminal. So again, you know, I'm intrigued with the idea that it's a completely unnatural system. You know, it's a bunch of pieces of metal and plastic and stainless steel, and but in its movement, in its behavior, it becomes like a register for what the atmosphere is doing. So it becomes something that's kind of in the sort of the gray area between a man-made thing and a nature-made thing. It's somewhere in between. It has it sort of blurs that boundary between man-made and nature-made. And so it's really nature. It's really the wind that sculpts it. You know, I conceived and my crew built the structure, but the structure is almost like a musical instrument that gets played by someone else, in this case, the atmosphere. So the light comes through it and the shadows you know, bounce off of the the rocks below, and the individual moving pieces, light bounces off one onto another, and this is from up in the far reaches of the hotel. And yeah, the farther back you get, you really start seeing what like whole gusts of wind look like. And the wind is, you know, every day different, every minute different. So it's something that's intrigued me as an artwork that's very inherently linked to what's exactly happening in this very moment. This thing that becomes a very subtle rendering detector of whatever the atmosphere is doing. This project was a collaboration with Gensler, the architectural firm that did the new hotel convention center complex and designed the plaza. So here it is kind of farther back, and again, you can kind of see the patterns kind of changing and being revealed at different distances. Here's another, this was another bleak urban plaza in Perth, Australia, on the west coast of Australia. This is very harsh stone and concrete plaza, and they wanted an artwork to kind of soften it a little bit. So I designed and built this array of, they were inspired by feathers. There's a bay right on the other side of this plaza that's called Swan Bay, and I just gotten intrigued with the idea of kind of feathers. And so these columns are surrounded by an array of four of these arrays of their very thin stainless steel kind of little fingers that are attached, but they're flexible enough that they move in the wind. And each one of these little kind of spines is reacting individually to the wind, but they somehow develop coordinated movements. They somehow kind of affect the way the wind hits each one, kind of deflects and activates the ones next to them, and the shadows and the light that come through them are constantly changing. And it's a super windy place. When I started the project, everyone told me, like, no one uses this plaza because it's really windy. So part of the intent was to kind of shift people's attitude about the wind. So instead of it just being viewed as this negative thing, to celebrate it, to make it interesting and to reveal it. All right, this is another collaboration on a landscape. This is with a landscape architecture firm called Walker Macy, based in Portland, Oregon, the other Portland. This is a park in downtown Sacramento, California, and it's right along the Sacramento River. And it's a site where there used to be these amazing docks back in the 1800s. It's the whole reason that Sacramento exists. This was as far as you could navigate up the Sacramento River. And this, these docks are completely been erased. There's just a few little tiny remnants of them, and but it's where all the boats loaded all the gold from the gold rush happened. And so my intent was to create an artwork that kind of suggested this totally forgotten past. And so it's a series of stainless steel, perforated stainless steel triangles, each one kind of, you know, slightly different size triangle, so that the whole form kind of suggests a boat or a vessel of some sort. And so it's just the wind moving these, and you look through these multiple layers of perforated metal, and you see kind of these complex moiré patterns. And it, from a distance, it really looks like water, which was kind of the intent, was to create like a sort of the opposite of a boat. You know, a boat is kind of this thing that's a vessel that excludes water, so it floats. And this was the idea of kind of a vessel that was made out of water. And there's also mist sprayers in between the layers. And Sacramento is a super hot, dry place in the summer. And so it's set up so when people walk underneath it, they activate a motion sensor that turns on these mist sprayers. And so you get bathed in a nice, cool mist. And here is, this is another big plaza project. This is in Singapore. This was a collaboration with Moshe Safdie. It's a huge hotel convention center waterfront complex, and Moshe needed a skylight kind of interrupting this big public plaza to bring light down to the lower levels of this big retail complex. And I talked everyone into making this kind of inverted skylight that would fill up with water. It collects rain, and then but it's also a recycling system that the steel structure that supports it is pressurized with water, and the water is injected so it rotates and it forms this huge vortex. The acrylic bowl that supports it all is 70 feet in diameter. It's like bigger than this auditorium. And so the water falls through a huge hole in the center of this into a pool below, and falls a couple stories down. And then the whole pool below functions as kind of a reservoir for the rain. And you also see this thing from a bunch of levels above it. And it's on a cycle, so every 20 minutes it fills. And it takes about 20 minutes to fill, and you get a huge amount of water in there. It's about an Olympic swimming pool full of water in this thing. And then it takes it about 20 minutes for that water to drain out. This is a project recently finished in LA, part of a development called Playa Vista. It's just north of the LAX airport. And it was a big blank public plaza that got baked in the LA sun. And I ended up collaborating with an architect a firm called Johnson Fain on this structure that's essentially a shade structure for this plaza. So the whole thing is about 100 feet tall. It's we built these giant ellipses of steel that attach to an existing parking structure. And then the kinetic part is a series of curtains that are made out of a plastic chainmail fabric. And it's this woven bunch of 10 million little plastic rings that are all woven together, and they're spaced in such a way that when the wind blows on it, the fabric kind of expands, and it basically, these waves that it creates are very analogous to the waves that wind creates over water. It you start off with little ripples, and then they grow in magnitude until you have these large waves passing. And then this is inside the structure. You look out through these multiple layers of this fabric, and you get these complex interference patterns between the layers, and the shadows pass through it and create these patterns on the floors and the walls. And there's a cafe and seating and chairs underneath it, and you look up through this veil. But it creates this weird illusion that it looks like the whole building is rotating, and it's really just the wind. And when we were installing this, we had a number of people come by who, like, you know, saw this thing and were convinced that we had some super high-tech way of making this whole building spin, and they were, like, desperate to see the software that we were running to do this. And they were slightly disappointed when, you know, they realized it's an incredibly simple thing. It's really just taking advantage of this beautiful phenomena that that nature is providing. But again, you know, sort of not real nature, kind of a murky ground between a man-made thing and natural. But it has a the feeling of water. It has like the soothing quality of, like, you know, of watching waves at the ocean. But again, you know, without you know, all the stuff that goes along with the traditional water feature, where you have to, you know, sterilize the water and maintain it and clean it. So it has the feeling of a water feature without all the maintenance. And this project, along with a lot of my other projects, was an incredible exercise in getting it approved by the local building department. So, you know, it was a basically, you know, we built this 100-foot-tall building for this thing, and they had never seen, you know, this plastic material. It was a year and a half of going to meetings with the planning and the building department before we finally had approval. We actually, there was a guy, my engineer for the project, it became his weekly job was to show up at LA Building Department and ask for our permit again. And how am I doing for time, Caitlin? 3 minutes, sorry, I'll just show one more. And this is one, my trusty assistant of many decades, Uva, who is sitting here, I was hoping that I wouldn't point him out, is, this was a project that Uva created and installed with me in Fort Worth, Texas. And it's in a traffic roundabout. And they're building a whole series of bridges over. They basically redirected the river that runs through downtown Portland. And in reorganizing the river, they had to stitch it back to the urban structure with a series of bridges. And they originally wanted me to work on the bridges, and there was all kinds of politics with the bridges, and they fired the bridge designer and got a new one. And then at some point they were like, well, there's this traffic roundabout where all these bridges kind of dump people back onto the land and want to do something there. And so the idea was, you know, I had done a lot of these kind of facade pieces for parking structures and other shade structures for buildings, so the idea was to take some of those planar pieces that I'd done and wrap it around into a cylinder. And so then, you know, it seemed like a simple idea, but when we got into it, you know, the fierce winds in Texas, it's one of the windiest places in the world, actually. And so, you know, the engineers basically, like, said, well, you need all kinds of, you know, structure to stabilize this thing. And so it was a fantastic amount of work for mostly torture for poor Uva here. And and then installing it, Uva put all these curved pieces up, put in all the substructure that links them all together, and then stretched these cables. There's basically an eighth-inch diameter, a little bit bigger, stainless steel cable spaced every 6 inches, kind of from the top ring to the bottom ring, and then 10,000 of these moving elements clamped to it. And so again, it becomes this register for whatever the atmosphere is doing. And each individual piece moves, but then also the whole thing acts like a fabric and kind of undulates and moves and resonates in the wind. So running out of time. So I guess each artist is going to present, and then there'll be time for questions and answers afterwards.
Hi, my name is Sarah Z, and I'm going to go through three public projects that I've done, and then talk a little bit about this site, my thoughts on this site in particular, and then show you three pieces of work that are not public, but the ideas, I think, relate to the site. This is a piece I did in New York City. It's on the corner of Central Park. And one of the challenges of this site was just that the amount of cacophony around the site is huge. It's right across from the Park Plaza. There are horses and carriages, you know, right to the right here. And this is a major intersection on the corner of Central Park. And so what I decided to do is try and harness the spectacle of the city itself and to actually imitate the catty corner of the building, but to place it in the sidewalk so that there was something that you recognized from the city, but it was an entirely different context. Something I'm interested in is how a work reads at night in an urban space and at day, so that you can have a night viewing, brings people back to the location to experience it in an urban night setting. So this piece was lit from the inside so that when you came up to it at night, you also had this view into an interior. I'm particularly interested in public art creating a kind of intimacy in a public space. So you have this kind of intersection of being in the outside, in the urban realm, but then having a moment of intimacy, a surprising moment of intimacy in a public space. So this is looking down into the interior. This piece goes about 12 feet underground in Manhattan. So when you get right up close to it, you have an entirely different sense of scale from the view of Manhattan, which is often looking up, down into this sort of miniature interior space. This is a piece I did in Washington. I did two versions of this piece. One is yellow, one is blue. And I put in this piece because I'm interested in this idea that a piece can become, feels like it became site-specific in the location. So it feels viral, it feels like it grew there, it feels like if you came there 2 days later, it might actually look different, that it has a kind of organic quality to its own making on that site. I'm interested in there being locations where you discover it in surprising ways, places where it peters, places where it grows, and has different kind of entries to it. So you can find it in a corner, you can find it in a main space. It can show up in many locations along a kind of path or a choreography over time. So this is the piece at MIT. It's on a dorm, and you actually come across it from pretty far away down a street. And from very far away, it just sort of feels like a blue streak across the building. But as you get closer, you start to see what it is. And the actual piece is, it's three sections. The idea was that I want to make this kit that actually would bring to a location and assemble it and would become site-specific. So it's three sections of a fire escape. There's a ladder, a stair, and a balcony. And they go together in any combination to climb a building, to inhabit a space. So this is one of the floors of the dormitory, and the piece climbed up and went actually to the top, and from the upper levels, you could see it on the roof. This is the third piece. I did this piece on the High Line in New York. The High Line, I think, is an incredible artwork in and of itself as a park, and there really was the question of how to make that park even better. And one of the things that I was thinking about was just this amazing experience of speed that the High Line offers in New York, because it is a railway in a city where you are constantly making a decision every block whether to go left or right. It's this railway which is this incredible respite from that decision making, in that you just go straight. It's a promenade. So I wanted the piece in form to actually feel like it sped in that kind of way you feel this, the speed of a Midwestern highway, in a way that you don't get usually in Manhattan. And I wanted to thrust you from again, the very, very minute out to the skyline of Manhattan. So that's the Empire State Building. I also wanted to think about the incredible nature that actually survives in New York. And on the High Line, they have an amazing array of butterflies, bees, birds. So each of these habitats, if you will, are designed around the existence of a very specific bird or a very specific butterfly in Manhattan. And they became feeding spots for those birds, butterflies, and bees. The last thing I think was really important for me about this project was to make a piece that you didn't just drive by or walk by. It wasn't an object that you could separate from the environment, but that it was, you actually went through the piece. You bisected the piece in the promenade so that there was a moment on this promenade where you were surrounded by the work itself. And you couldn't pass it, you couldn't separate it from the environment. There's this moment where you sort of realize you are in the work, and that boundary between what a work is and what environment is and what an artwork is gets blurred. So this is the coast of Maine. I've grown up coming to Maine to visit relatives and friends, and I have a real love for it. In thinking about this location, because it was always a stopping point for me to go further into Maine, but a very exciting stopping point, I was thinking about the location, and I really felt like it was a place that had potential for many pockets of activity in the square that a trail, that an idea of a narrative of a trail, not just one object that sat in the middle of the park, but several objects, perhaps one with like a mother rock that actually held the space. But then you would go through the park and you would find other locations, in the series. You'd find a kind of discovery and unraveling, or a trail, if you will, in the space. This idea, that, again, this is a preliminary idea, but this idea of a sort of a split rock that then has an imprint that the weight of that rock feels like it made that print on the ground. I am a sculptor, but I'm also a printmaker, and I love this idea of the pressure of a block creating a print, and that moment of discovery when you lift the actual block. And so this idea, I think, comes directly from that. This is a sculpture I did in a high school, the biggest high school in the Bronx in New York. And we use this very beautiful technique of a kind of terrazzo technique of cutting into the tile and having the shadow of the sculpture cut into the ground below. So in a place where you actually couldn't have access to touching the sculpture itself, that was quite fragile, you actually have this kind of intimate experience of it on the ground in that high school, in the reflection on the ground. That's just another picture of a print being pulled, and this idea of reflection on the ground. And this idea of sort of an organic kind of architecture, a sculpture that actually feels as if you discover it in natural space, a kind of mimicking of a discovering of locations through a park or through a space. I think, to me, is very much about mimicking what I think is this incredible experience of nature, where you have these moments where the unexpected happens. And to try and mimic that in the placement of an artwork is something that I try and do. So this is a piece of mine from Venice. These are not permanent pieces. I did a work in Venice at the American Pavilion. And the American Pavilion is when you go to the Venice Biennale, it's the place everyone goes. And I wanted to sort of make it more dispersed, make a trail to pull that location out and fracture it. So I made these rocks. They're actually, they are photographs of rocks that are then printed on Tyvek, so printed on FedEx material. So it's actually extremely resilient. And then I put them throughout Venice. This is where we did our grocery shopping. This is a grocery store in Venice. Comes up and there's the rock. And everyone in the neighborhood, actually, we asked if they wanted a rock. Everyone said they wanted a rock. They owned the rocks. They took care of the rocks. They were all there in perfect condition after 7 months. And so you would see them. This is where we got our newspapers. You would see them throughout the city. And you might see them on your way there. And then when you got to the pavilion, you sort of understood that they were part of the pavilion. Or you might see them after you went to the pavilion and then realize that they were part of the pavilion, but that it left this trail over time and space and in one's memory. So that's the pavilion. You can see them all. So they're all piled up in the space. This is a piece I did at San Francisco MoMA, and it is a five-part piece. It's actually a Jeep Cherokee that was cut into five pieces and then splayed down the entire atrium. But this idea that you would see from afar, you sort of see it as a streak of red, and when you get up close, you start to understand what it is, you recognize it, but in a very different context. And this is the back, if you can see, this is is overhanging the atrium. That's the back hatch open, and this looks out over the atrium. But I like this shot for this, also this idea that when you come in, it has this incredible presence in a very large abstract way. And then as you move closer, you have this very, very interior, fragile, more intimate experience of a work. That scale shift, the last piece, non-permanent piece I'll show you is this sort of, I sort of decided to do a piece where that scale shift was really the central idea of the work. So this is called Portable Planetarium. And I was really thinking about this moment where we see images of the Earth, and you have this kind of sense suddenly of how small you are in space and time. And often the camera will move away from the Earth. And in this case, you go closer and closer to the piece. And when you get to the piece at the center, you're nested in it, and you're sort of centered inside the work itself. In that transition, I think, is a kind of shocking intimacy in this work. And this is the last slide I'll show you. This is a permanent piece that I'm working on right now that is actually done and will be open to the public in the new year, or I would say probably more like March. It's a 14-year project in the making. It's a 96th Street subway station in New York, and they've added three stations to that line, and for each station they've asked one artist to do every single entryway and every single waiting dock. So it's a very, very immersive experience, and I think it will be exciting when the three stations open. Thank you.
It's great to be up here with three other amazing artists. My work is primarily based in the inherent features of a site, the things that interest me, and then I introduce my artistic perspective to kind of sharpen that dynamic exchange between myself and the space, but hopefully the public as well. So some of these, the first group of images I'm going to show you are works that aren't necessarily public, but approach. This is a piece from 2000, and it's just it's basically string suspended inside a grain silo. And I was a resident artist on Nantucket Island, where I would work with this silo in many different ways, but this piece would almost track and collect the sunlight throughout the day. It also breathed like a lung with the air movement. And of course, the children at school, the adults at the school, they all interacted with it. It was a very tactile piece. It was temporary, too. That summer, a hurricane did eventually come close enough that it was totally destroyed. And that was one of the first times or experiences I realized that there was this emotional connection to a work, too. And it was really impressive to me to see the people that did interact with it be upset. It was tangled and gone. But this piece kind of continued to interest me with other cable and string installations and different volumes, architecture, once again capturing the light in specific ways. It's a way that sometimes I'll understand architecture and the proportions and the volume. Let's start. And allow the viewer to reconsider their orientation. Sometimes these are installations to walk through, to pass through, to touch. Sometimes they're too fragile to necessarily touch, but they just introduce almost a different dimension to a gallery space or an outdoor space. A lot of times they inform me as I'm making them, so the public is almost seeing just shortly after what I see, experiencing the same experience. I know there's an outcome that I'm interested in, but a lot of times I don't really know where it's going to lead. It's an example of a piece that, as a young artist, I'd work, I still work in the landscape quite a bit, but sometimes just making momentary pieces to capture a shadow. Stitched across a landscape, which, these disconnect after a couple minutes as the sun passes. And I introduced this to the Botanic Gardens in Denver, also referencing the fences and the barbed wire fences across the West that have changed that landscape. but this moment where all the shadows align and bisect the landscape and sketch across it. And then, you know, a lot of these people passing through may not have noticed it, but there was there were these points every day where it connect and then disconnect. And I'm interested in those moments, those time-based ideas. And the idea of collecting light, these pieces are some studio works. I'm just continually exploring, and obviously I'm not collecting, you know, I'm not holding, containing light, but trying to represent that and the urge to do so. And then to somehow take these containers and collide them or intersect them or create intersections, really. And with this piece, implying these spherical volumes in a very dark material, this is graphite, to also interest the viewer to come up closer, look through that intersection, and then you realize there's an audible volume surrounding you too, as the sound waves behave differently in a volume like this. Taking it to a different material, once again going back to something more luminous, with glass, which then introduced a whole new dynamic of results with these interlacing fissures that started to lead to questions of geometry and temperature is basically what would cause these cracks. And how to resolve that further. All these pieces are these continual experiments. And how to capture what's going on with that. This is basically a photogram. So this is a 48 by 48 black and white silver gelatin photograph. The paper directly placed on the glass, using the glass like a lens, and registering the way the light is passing through all that. So I did a series of these this past year, these large scale black and white photo prints, photograms, basically removing the camera from the process. But all of these explorations inform the way I approach public art commissions. I try to approach each site specifically and treat it as a new project to inform this approach I developed in the studio. This is basically a fence. It's a barrier between City Park and Denver Zoo. The original intention was to create this horizontal sense of movement and this composition. But I was also informed by the feathers. I think Ned had a feather piece too, and there's something incredible about that micro-architecture. And this was an avian propagation center at the Denver Zoo, so there were feathers everywhere. And they were informing my impression of the site. So the early drawings and sketches that I would do on site started to kind of reveal this feathery form. Most of my projects, I work from sketches, and I respond to a site this way with charcoal. To create this piece, we salvaged a tremendous amount of basically steel pipe. This commission was during the Chinese Olympics, and the steel market was crazy. And we had to resolve how we were going to accommodate the scale of this piece. So all this was salvaged steel pipe. Unfortunately, most fabricators won't work with salvaged pipe, so me and my crew rolled and welded everything for this one, which was a great lesson in making the piece as I go, and sticking with, I guess the challenges become opportunities. And, this is a piece in Denver as well. I titled this Virga. We have a lot of Virga. The rain a lot of times does not reach the ground. Virga is basically the rain falling from the cloud, but it evaporates before it actually hits the ground. And our arid climate, we see a lot of that. The moisture just passes us by. This was a piece on a train trellis downtown. It's now a pedestrian bridge. But the idea was to reflect this, the sky that's behind you from whatever perspective you're approaching it. Once again, starting with an impression of what I was hoping to create in this sense of Virga suspended in this train trellis, or trestle, sorry. And then the idea of the pedestrians floating past it, the way that we're going to be watching just float past us. You'll have these moments where it just completely pops from the landscape as the sky behind you, whether it's sunset or sunrise. And then certain points in the day just completely disappears as well. And then this is interesting. I feel like this piece relates to your plaza or the square. This piece has started to activate this bridge as a place for events. It's kind of funny. It's a bagpipe performance. But a composer in Denver was inspired by the chromatic shifts evident with the piece and that he watched, and he composed a piece that the reason they were bagpipers was he composed it in just intonation, and we couldn't really get a pipe organ out there. So he wanted to maintain this composition he'd come up with. But it has started, the bridge has started to create another personality to this part of downtown Denver, where events, sometimes there'll be bands that play on there now, or a lot of weddings. This is a piece I recently finished up in Calgary at the National Music Center that they just finished building. And this is basically a sound installation as well as a sculptural installation composed of salvaged sound boards from pianos that were part of their collection. It's placed in the sky bridge that connects two sides of the museum or the center. On one side you have the record of the music that's been made, and on the other side, where it's made, they have all these studios and opportunities to produce music. It's a solar-based work, so these are the solar panels on top of that sky bridge, and those directly send a current individually to each unit that causes an electromagnetic system to activate a piano wire on each one, creating a tone. So you have 16 of these. This is Morton Waller. He actually tuned them for the first year. And sometimes they'll all play together, maybe one, maybe three. But they're all based off the characteristics of the sky. They'll change octaves sometimes. But it's kind of an unpredictable piece that way. You don't know what you're going to hear. Sometimes it's silent. It's all dependent on the angle of the sun. And then, the conditions of the sky. These soundboards taken from these pianos are from, they had a flood 3 years ago in Calgary. Basically, there was a foot of water everywhere in Calgary. So part of their collection was just completely destroyed. So I was able to reuse these Steinways and stuff. I couldn't believe I was cutting up these gorgeous pianos, but I guess they had enough. This is a piece, I think Ned and I have both been attracted to the wind and the movement of wind. This is called the Windmill Project. I started this in Iceland about 15, 16 years ago. And the idea was, I was living in Iceland in the dark. I had the dark and I had the wind and I wanted that to be my medium. So I created these basically windmills that would generate a quality of light depending on the velocity or the force of the wind. I would hoof these out in the landscape each day. At the time, there was about 300 of them, and since it has grown. But the idea is just translating the evening winds into this living body of light. And there is something interesting about a man-made system translating this and introducing this dynamic. I hope it's dark enough. Yeah, you guys should be able to see this. But it kind of, once again, there's that unpredictable quality, and sometimes the wind doesn't blow. And going back to that first piece that basically was destroyed by the wind, there's this this response to people they expect to see something to be able to just turn it on, and I can't turn this on. I put it in place, and it either works or it doesn't. And I think that's interesting to introduce that disappointment sometimes. If we could simply flip it on, then it could be like right now. Let's just put it on the TV. These waves and eddies of light, This was in Vail. I also did it in Burlington, Vermont, and of course, Iceland. There's a little more. And of course, you can walk among these as well. This is the piece I did for the Denver International Airport that's near Ned's piece as well. Basically 236 beetle kill spruce from the Rio Grande National Forest in Colorado. Denver, it's funny, you mentioned the way they approached you about your site. They also approached me. We have this valley. Yeah, we don't know what to do with it. It's been engineered, but it hasn't been designed. Can you do something? And I spent a lot of time in the site, studying it and trying to get familiar with it. It was still very much a construction site when I was coming up with my approach. But it was very clear that the solar exposure and just the vast scale of this valley were going to be dominant in whatever I do. And I needed to somehow work with that. So I created a piece that casts a shadow array. It's always changing, it's always moving, but it's a very different frame of mind in terms of time and when we travel and how quickly everything moves. And the idea of slowing down for a moment to notice these shadows, and nonetheless the fact that the shadows are moving throughout the day. I just thought I'd show this. Sometimes people ask, you know, how do you make these things? And a very simple idea certainly becomes very complex in execution, but we peeled these logs from the forest for about 18 months, and then basically calibrated them all and created the infrastructure to place them. And what was great about this piece too is it did employ a lot of local craftsmen and enthusiasts, artists in Colorado, maybe a team of 20. Helped install it, and to involve that many people in something on this scale, I think it did inform the piece and how it came together and how it engaged the community. And it was something I'm very proud of, having, you know, it being my home and my home airport, and somewhere where I and a lot of friends travel on a regular basis. You have the variations throughout the year in terms of seasons and, of course, daily shifts. And then there's a nighttime presence as well. I created a lighting program or a lighting effect that I wanted it to, one, embrace and greet the twilight and the way the quality of light at twilight starts to almost vibrate with the sky. And then as the sky grows darker and darker, it takes on its own own life, its own personality, and almost mimics tides or a shift that comes in throughout the night. Of course, this is time lapse, so it moves much slower than what you're going to see. But so the idea is that if you're staying in the hotel, or having dinner on the plaza, or taking the time to sit and enjoy, you'll start to see these shifts and transitions in lighting that activate the valley as well as the piece itself, and hopefully engage you in a different sense of time. And I think that is the final slide, or video. Thank you.
I am actually a super main fan. I've been coming here for 25 years, much like Sarah. So this project has a special sort of place in my heart, and I really wish you the very best with it, because I always thought that sort of Maine hasn't quite yet had the art it deserves, but it's clearly going to get it. So this is a little bit of my... Oh, yes, you want me to do this? Slideshow. Yeah. corrected already. I began as a gallery artist, so my transition into public art took place through a show at Mass MoCA, where I started working on a very large scale with these kind of transparent forms and large-scale sculptures, much like every artist that kind of moves into public sculpture. You suddenly find yourself infatuated with shadow and light and change, and you're like, my goodness, it's amazing what happens to things when they become life-size. So this sculpture was there. And it gradually led me into some private projects where I moved from the gallery to the outdoors. But my real transition was a kind of birth of fire, where I got a project with the GSA in Washington, D.C., which organizes these national things. They gave me a project in Eugene, Oregon, in a courthouse with a bunch of judges who kind of didn't want the art there. And it was my first real introduction to the public art process, like how, you know, not only, and this is something I want to sort of introduce early because I'll come back to it a few times, not only how difficult it is, but also how important it is, because the whole purpose of art in the public sphere is that it engages the public, not just a small subset of the public who happen to like art already, but that you're dealing with people who have to learn to appreciate art over time. And so this introduction to the time element and the idea of a narrative and a shared story, which is very central to my original practice, became very important. I'm going to show you four projects where I think that's expressed in different ways. This particular one, these little heads are made by local school children. And the way we got around this big discussion about these kind of very conservative judges was this, I developed this kind of map of the Willamette River system, and I mapped the history of justice onto it. And this became a way for us to talk about, so these are some other installations about this idea of participation. And another thing I'm going to show you is over the years, I've become very much involved with the performing arts, which is really always about telling a story. So these two things kind of came together as like find the building blocks in any given situation and build the story out of that. My work looks very complex, but every time it's the same thing going on. It's find the through line, find the drawing, draw the map, and build the story. So this project is a version of that. I was commissioned by a Viennese foundation to do a project that turned out to be a map of the universe, the biggest story of all. So I worked with some physicists, and they also wanted it to be durable, transportable, modular, fractal, able to survive in all climates, inside and out, be shown anywhere in the world, and be legible to any culture in the world. It was a great, you know, you got nothing in terms of complexity. It's an easy project. So this is it at the Venice Architecture Biennial. We did a sort of test. And the key to this project is that, as it shows in this, this is the map. Every little block is a fractal part of the system and can support and fit with any other block. Much as Sarah was sort of describing this idea of an opportunistic installation, I think this is a common theme for public art practices. You have to be able to roll with the punches. So this piece can be assembled indoors, or you can make it much, much bigger and assemble it outdoors. And every single one of the components, you know, they range from this size to the size of half this room, supports all the other ones in any orientation. And then it could has to work at night, because it's this kind of notion of like, what do we do with public space at night? And then it has to also be able to operate. That was in Sevilla, this is in Istanbul, in the busiest square in Istanbul. It's got traffic, it's got ferries. It's also the second piece of public art to be shown in Istanbul. So the audience had very complex reactions to it. They were like, because it plays music all the time. I'll show you a little bit of that in a second. So when they liked the music, they would sort of make kind of like little kind of, like they kind of thought it was alive, I think. And we're talking about people really from kind of almost a medieval agrarian society coming in with their vegetables. They would sort of beckon to it to make more music. And when they didn't like it, which was quite a bit because it had some, it's 40 different compositions by different musicians, they would throw little stones at it, like hoping that it would stop, which I thought was a great kind of model of interactivity in public. The piece is super strong. You can climb to the top of it. You know, kind of like we had like 50 people standing on it. And it became a sort of, in Vienna, it became very different. It's a party space, you know, it's a kind of thing. And it's also a environment for musicians to perform, and the whole thing is wired for sound. So every little one of the smallest bricks has a speaker inside. And I don't think we have sound here, but you can see. So it evolves through the day. Here we go. From that kind of thing, to this is one of the commissioned pieces for it. This is a band called Sigur Rós, and they would perform it. And this is one of the ones where people were like, yes, give us more. And obviously it had to be all kinds of weather conditions. And then some of the other pieces are much more aggressive. This is Lee Ronaldo from Sonic Youth. So this was kind of more into the Let's Throw Stones at it, and then it kind of got worse from there. But the idea was to create something that was sort of both a performance space and a sculpture, and that kind of got inverted in a number of projects after that, where I kind of tried to turn performances back into sculptures. So I worked with a lot of musicians and composers in different environments, and very much part of each project is also, where is the audience? And we're used to this kind of situation. But what happens when you break that, when you allow people to just participate in it as if they were moving around a sculpture, as if they're in a social space with the performance work? So breaking the proscenium, but not only that, but creating an environment where the entire interior of a space becomes a kind of a sculpture itself, that everyone is, in a sense, a performer. And once you make that decision, then you can start to make all kinds of beautiful things happen in every part of the space, which is, I think, a central thing. And then you can also begin to reconsider the role of the outside as a potential site where everyone is essentially performers participating. Another project I thought was particularly relevant here is a garden that I've just almost completed. Talk about long-term projects. This is a 10-year, began under the Bush administration. But it's a tough site. I thought this was interesting too for you guys. You know, it's a roof over a vivarium, 6 inches of depth of soil over most of it, 2 over the rest. They were like, they wanted just a sculpture, and I was like, I'd like to do a garden. They're like, well, you've never done a garden. I was like, no, but can I? And they're like, well, you can here, because this place sucks. And we don't know what to do with it. So really, there was kind of no loss. So we made this, I built a strategy with the horticulturalists and the landscape designers. They were also like, we have no maintenance budget for your art garden. So it has to be totally self-sufficient, requiring at most 2 maintenance visits a year. So this is a thing called Grimes Triangle, which I love, because it's also a kind of map of us. It's like there's 3 kinds of creatures in the world. There's competitors, stress tolerant, and ruderals, which are the ones that sort of hide and come back again, which is sort of like me, an artist. So we built a vocabulary of plants that was, each one was one of these 3. So whenever one dies off, another one will move in. That's the sort of rule of Grimes Triangle. And then we made this map, which is also a taxonomical history that became the roof. And it's a history of the evolution of plants, from the very oldest plants at the deepest end of the roof to the newest plants at the shallowest end, because they're the ones, the stress tolerators that finally moved out to like the Arctic or Colorado and live on that little rock on the roof in Venice, just holding on. So this is one of the earliest trees, a monkey puzzle tree. So these are just pictures of it. Now it's about 2 years old. It's just really starting to settle in. But amazingly enough, we planned it out so carefully that we haven't had to add or take away any species. There's just a few, the inevitable, you know, horseweed and crabgrass that gets in everywhere. But I was kind of amazed at the ability of carefully planned organic life to sort of be choreographed and become a performer in this kind of drama of this space. And people love it. It's full of different food groups. So the things are beginning to fill in now with these various kinds of characters. And the last piece I'm going to talk about, and then I want to talk a little bit about your site, is a project I did a couple of years ago at the ICA Boston. They asked me to address the museum as a whole and also the entire city around it. The ICA is getting a bit old. It's 10 years old. It was a building of the future, and now it's like in that kind of difficult phase. You know, it's like a kid who's turning from a kid to a teenager, and it's not quite as fresh as it used to be. So they wanted to reinvent it. And a part of the premise of my practice is that there's always a story and there's always a map of how people behave. So the one in the top is the philosopher's diagram. That's the storyteller's diagram. This is what people in corporate planning use. And this is what architects use. It's Kiesler's fourfold for co-realism. But there's always a map, there's always a drawing you can make. So we applied those systems to the ICA. It's this funny building which has this kind of big cantilever. It all seemed super cool at the time, and now, you know, it's too small and yet also large. So I also started to throw in, you know, the whole idea of New England as this kind of shining city on the hill. And what do we do about the reinvention of America? I'm a recent immigrant here. I feel very passionately about what America is, what it can, has sort of still yet become, that the story is very much not written. So this was about, sort of, this is on the Boston Greenway. It's an 80-foot by 80-foot painting on the wall that became a kind of reference to the interior of the building. This was in a local chapel, the Longshoremen's Chapel. We used that as a way to reach out to a very different community, the people who are just regular churchgoers who hadn't maybe even gone to the ICA, even though it's 4 or 5 blocks away. We did performances in the space and engaged in a very complicated dialogue with the priest. It's a Seaman's church you can see there. So, of course, you have to tread very carefully. A lot of my storytelling is about this kind of aspirational state, and priests are quite rightly, you know, proprietary about aspirational states. You know, it's kind of their stock in trade. So you have to have a very rich, and you, but again, this is going back to the idea, like, public space is for everybody. We're all in this together. And if we're not all in it together, then we're not talking about public space. I'm very interested in developing those conversations over time. That's why I've worked with so many different kinds of collaborators. Inside the building, that drawing from the street became echoed on the wall out there, the glass. And this became a space for the public to, that's a sound sculpture. So the kids, as they run up and down, they generate a sound sculpture. There's a poetry reading, did musical performances. So we moved from the city into the art space and back into the city without creating a division between the two things. There would be kind of these informal kind of performance events where people were now sometimes in costume, sometimes out of it. The audience were invited up on stage, tarot readings, very classical performances, kids. Oh, kind of big feature of my practice in general as working with these performance things is you've got to be able to hang up an electric guitar, right? And it's got to look good. It can't look like you've imported all this stuff and it's spoiling the art space. You've got to create a kind of participatory relationship. So look, and in terms of your space, so here's a few thoughts just to leave you all with that I thought was amazing about the space being here. We've come through, my wife and I, a couple of times on our way up and on our way back. It's working, it's pretty great. Like, it's a great space. It's got a great aspect, it's got a lot of properties. We were asked, I don't know if this is part of the Q&A, but we were asked, and there was a very formal letter saying, you must address this question of what are the challenges. It's a great space, but there's a lot of challenges, right? And I'm sure you all know that. It's hard to take care of parks. You have to get people to buy in. Whatever you put there, they have to love it, or they'll hate it, you know? That's kind of how it goes. So we've got to kind of build a consensus around that. But more importantly than that, I think the opportunity here, and I hope you'll consider it, whichever the artist you choose, is there's an opportunity to do something a little bit more exciting and interesting, something that I love about the northern cities, especially Maine, is it doesn't have to be another bland corporate plaza, you know, of the kind where you hire Ned to, it's like, please save us with something interesting because we've made this horrible mistake. From the roots up, it seems like you're considering an organic investigation of form that's fully integrated, which I think is fantastic. And that really is what I think all of us are very inspired by, is the opportunity here to make something that's more than just a response to a blankness, but something that participates in the life of the city at every level, that's legible at every level, that creates complex social spaces, that allows multiple generations of people, not just one or two generations, but allows multiple generations of people to sort of, well, use the corny city motto, kind of rise up. And these are a few spaces that I thought, in the same sort of spirit that Sarah was talking about, are interesting versions of that. I also had a picture of a rock that I'd done with a drawing on it, but yours was, you know, much, you spent more time on it. So mine was just the kind of rock with a drawing on it in front of the museum. But I did put these in. But so this is the Irish Hunger Memorial in New York, that's in Noguchi Park. These are all sort of ways in which I think there's this kind of potential for the space, especially this notion of it being a theater. I think the world has changed since the 1980s when those kind of desolate plazas, which were places of fear, has gone, and we are now in a realm where we appreciate the realm of the public space, a place where we can all feel dignified, where we can feel like we're participants in the life of a city. And, you know, there's obviously the winter thing here, a little bit. But sometimes no snow, right? So it's very tough to create. I think that's one of the interesting challenges of it. And then there's also the possibility, from my perspective, you can obviously see I like very iconic, sort of dramatic environments. I think that's a property the public space is permitted. It doesn't have to be afraid of drama. You look at these, that's on Monhegan. There's another boat, and that's in Rome, and it looks pretty good. Like, you can actually do, we can take risks with public space. And that's what, so to leave you with this sort of image, I think there's this possibility for the full integration of landscape into public life, which creates a kind of sense that we're all living in this together. Thank you.
So I'm going to ask the four artists to please come up to the stage for the question and answer. Everyone was so efficient with time, so we're right on schedule. We will have Lynn with a mic floating in the audience, so if you have a question, please signal to her and she'll come over with the microphone. You can direct your question to one artist in particular or all the artists. We have about a half an hour left, so plenty of time for questions.
You're in the hot seat.
Can we get the lights up?
So I'm actually going to start with a question of my own, which some of you addressed a little bit, but if you could just reiterate for us what excites you about our project in Congress Square. Anyone can start.
I'll start. I was initially pretty excited, one, because it is Maine, and I used to visit Maine as well when I was in college in it. There's something about people that go through what you guys go through in the winter to then be rewarded with a day like today, but it does affect the community and how you behave, and that was something that really attracted me, as well as the fact that this is an intersection of those people. I mean, just, we saw it even while we were meeting today, but the variety of people in the public square, it's really impressive already who's using it, and that's something that I would want to embrace and maintain. I think right now it attracts pretty much everyone, all walks of life, and that's great to see in the city, whereas a lot of times it's either one or the other. I'll let you guys.
I love Maine more. But I think we wouldn't be here if we all really, because you get invited to locations and you have an attraction to that location. So that, I think we're all here for that. I think Matthew brought up something that is really nice about this site that probably we're all attracted to is doing public art, which is that it has the potential to be very live, very active, and in very multiple ways. That you could, the artwork could really be integrated in experience and in multiple kinds of experience throughout the park. And as we all talked about, as a public artist, you often get asked to basically, you know, solve the space between the parking lot and the airport because they need a distance for protection, for actual protection. That's one very common public art problem now, is, right, we've all been asked this, that you, if airports need drop off to have a certain distance and then they have this dead space. But to have a space that is really a lived in live space, I think is and that potential here in Maine in an incredible city is rare and really exciting.
I also think, I mean, just personally, I think Portland's been one of those cities for years. We come here and thought, well, you know, this place is on its way. It's totally on its way. And then you sort of come back a few years later, it's like, it's on its way. It's totally on its way now. A few years later, it's got to be on its way now, hasn't it? Which is true of a lot of the cities on the sort of, you know, the, well, the Amtrak corridor, even like Baltimore and Camden, New Jersey. It's like a lot of the cities, you know, they've struggled. And they struggled with an industrial infrastructure that's collapsing and a way of life that's changing and people that have really had to adjust their one kind of model of living to another kind of model of living. And now another one is being thrust upon them. And I think the opportunity for me is certainly that it's sort of national, not just here, but it's specific here, is the kind of leapfrog past the kind of Bloomberg era improvements of New York, which were very much about, you know, let's make it safe, let's make it nice, let's make it plain, let's make it simple for a kind of anonymized citizen. I don't see Portland as that kind of city where the where you just want to create an anonymous public plaza with something in it. I think it's a place, I think that all the artists are good choices for that. It's a city with a really very strong and vibrant history and identity, and that kind of is super exciting because it's how I've always felt about it.
Thank you. Questions from the audience? And please don't forget to fill out your survey. We are interested in your thoughts. The online survey will be up through Friday if you would prefer to respond online.
Hi. My question is specifically at this point for Ned Kahn. Most of the things that you showed, things were moving, and I was wondering what kind of noise those various things make?
A variety of, not making too much noise with my microphone. Some of them are totally silent, some of them are projects kind of, you know, for hospitals or hotels where they were like, you know, this thing can't annoy anyone, and so we went through a lot of trouble to make them totally silent. And some have been projects that actually the sound was an important part of it. Like the first video I showed, a project in Pittsburgh with the kind of big sphere of clouds makes a beautiful hissing sound, and the hissing sound, you hear the hissing sound, you also hear drips of water coming. It kind of drowns out the city noise. It kind of gives you something natural-ish to listen to instead of the cars going by. So it has the property to kind of create like an acoustic oasis in addition to a visual one.
How about the waving things on the curtains on the
party? That one's completely silent. And some of the other ones, we did a skin for the Pittsburgh Children's Museum, and they actually asked us to make something noisy to kind of, you know, because it's a museum full of a bunch of screaming kids, and so you know, they wanted sound in that case.
Okay, all right, thanks.
I'm interested in what your first experience, what you imagine your first experience with the landscape architect will be with this site. When you get together and you're looking at it and all the ideas are running rampant.
From past projects, I know it'll be, these are the issues that kind of will go through all the challenges probably that are going to have to be overcome and the limitations, and then how can you turn those into opportunities or where can you go from that. But typically that's the way working with an architect or a landscape architect or a design team is, we don't have enough money, we don't have enough space, and we, these are our set of limitations, and now how do we get creative with this and do what we do best? But you guys?
I try and start with what's the vision of that particular firm? What do they think they do best? And then where do we meet? And where does that conversation, where do our strengths overlap? And where does that conversation lead us? Start very abstractly with goals and what we do, what we particularly, what our language is, and what we do well.
Yeah, I think one of the advantages, I don't know how if you've been following the process, but the museum and the Friends of Congress Square have done an enormous amount of pre-visioning and studies in public. So there's a huge amount of data to be said that's already kind of on the table. And it sort of defines our presence here as public artists as one of the things people wanted, or we wouldn't even be here probably. They'd said we want ice cream trucks and a dog run and no art. Different meeting, different part of town, right? So happily there's this kind of like, but then there's also kind of question of like, can you articulate something that's unexpected from the site? Like, what haven't you thought? What hasn't everybody thought of yet? Like, go through that kind of brainstorming and then place it right next to the budget, which will be the other. And so they go, okay, can we, where can we go from here? But there's kind of where there's a will is a way. And that's the kind of spirit that it seems like you have to get into with these projects.
I'm wondering if any of you feel that your own very private vision is more encompassing than these sort of general visions that you seem to put out as going to almost be a solve or a calming effect for everybody. So I want to know if any of you feel like you're a ticket maker here as opposed to taking us somewhere, as opposed to making a general statement that's comforting.
I'm not sure I understood the question. When you said ticket maker, is that what you said?
Yeah.
People will come to actually see the work rather than just solve problems. So, did you
understand? You're stretching us.
That we're stretching you with the work that we're putting. I mean, for me, that would be the only reason to do it. I mean, I think for me, the role of a visual artist is to create a situation that is transformative in that moment, that you carry with you way beyond this location, that's magnetic, that brings you to the location, that changes on the first visit to the 20th visit. And that is challenging. And I think, I think there's a landscape architect and then there's an artist, and for that collaboration solves problems. But I think in a lot of ways with this site, the landscape artist can actually solve most of the problems. And for me in this project, the artist is, for me personally, I want to create a moment that is quite profound. And that may, that's a high goal, but for me, that's why I do what I do.
I think that public art does tend to attract the other approach that maybe you're referring to in terms of something that's safe. It's something that's maybe comfortable or is going to be received by the masses. I think we're all up here because we take risks and we do stretch. And I don't think we would have been invited here if we weren't the artists that are going to push it from the perspectives we have. I know I certainly take a lot of risks, but I try to make them calculated, but a lot of them fail in my studio before I get to the pub.
To pull the lens a little further back, I started as an artist and now I'm a landscape architect, and so I'm conflicted with myself on many projects. But I love the work presented. I would love to experience it, not all at the same time, but very interesting and stimulating. And a lot of you dealt with cycles of light, cycles of seasons, you know, modeled after natural cycles. But there's a larger looming cycle, and it's cultural, and it involves taste and perception and everything. And since there's no cool insurance available, how do you design for something that's timeless, that won't be like a Richard Serra ripped up in 12 years and sent to the scrapyard or something, but something that will really evolve with the city and its growing community, which evolves in itself?
Well, I think, you know, part of it is having a really informed public participate in the process. There's a lot of this kind of the approach for the 1970s, like a lot of urban plazas and a lot of building and a lot of, frankly, architecture at every level from landscape, was here's what you get, like lump it or leave it, which is also sort of Richard Serra's personal approach to life. He's a lovely guy, but it's like my way or the highway. And I think that the cultural context has changed, and there's a far more, and it's not that it, I mean, the risk is that filters out difference and ambition. But the advantage of that is it allows an opportunity to articulate, you know, at a time when our culture really is changing very radically, some of the most ambitious opportunities that our culture can have for complexity and ambition in public life. So I guess the answer is sort of in two parts. It's like, one, aim as high as you possibly can, and two, embrace the process as something that can help that, like that, rather than something that's inevitably going to hinder it. But be very cautious, and like you guys, it's sort of like a process that needs to be kind of iterated multiple times so that voices are heard, like I had with the judges in Eugene. But by the end of that project, they were the biggest fans. One of them came up to me with tears in his eyes and was like, this is just the greatest thing that ever happened here. But at the beginning of it, he was like, this money should be spent on the war in Iraq. So, you know, like, yeah, there's a cultural cycle, but we're all in it. And all you can do is like, do your very best to make it as ambitious and so, you know, significant as you can possibly imagine it can be for that time, and hope that you get it right.
I mean, I also think it's important that the public attached to art does not divorce it from a critical process and critical thinking, and therefore public art is not made, I don't think, to please or to be a salve or to be decorative. Look at something like the Picasso sculpture in Philadelphia. It was, you know, criticized by every single newspaper in Philadelphia. It's a national treasure, you know. So you have to have some, I think, trust with an artwork that if it's going to be timeless, it's something that you learn over time, and that, you know, it's important that people are critical of it. But it isn't. I mean, Sarah is a very specific example because it was so difficult, just in very, very practical ways. But for aesthetic reasons, you know, you have to be to accept fine art is to accept not a process that is about pleasing, right? It's about critical thinking. It's about challenging, which may go back to that question that you were talking about. That I think, you know, for people to want great public art, they have to accept a critical platform for it, and not, and personally, that it's not, that it has to, you have to accept that it isn't going, that's why it separates itself from design. Because, and that's, I think, for me, why I was talking about the idea of intimacy, that I think when you're in front of a public art or any artwork, you're having a conversation with the artist. And that's a very intimate experience about what it is to be human that I think an artwork can carry.
Hi, I really enjoyed the presentations very much. Thank you. I'm wondering if you would each tell us perhaps one or two artists that you really respect, could be public art or not, just to get a feel of who you think is really doing it. Any century as well.
Any century, wow.
I'll start with, they've both been artists that have influenced me throughout my career, but Maya Lin and then Ann Goldsworthy, who I had the fortune to work with and be his apprentice for a few years. So And that may be obvious in some of the work I do.
No, it's totally not obvious. I would never guess that. If you listed like 100 artists, I would never guess that is. But he's great, and he goes with him.
Who's next?
I'll name two off the top of my head. I think that Anish Kapoor's piece in Chicago is a very successful public artwork. I'll call it the bean because that's what it's called. I said this earlier. I think when a public artwork is actually given a nickname, you know that it's actually owned, and it doesn't matter who made the work anymore, that it's actually owned in a public way. And I'll put out Bernini because I think, you know, the transformation of space in you know, whether it's architecturally or any of his objects, particularly in three dimensions, that activate the space around. You know, that's one of the things that I think is really interesting about this park, is how many intersections of entry you have and how you can create sort of eddies of activity within it. And then Bernini had this incredible way of an object actually spinning off behavior around it.
And I've been influenced a lot by the work of James Turrell, Robert Irwin, people interested in sort of perception and kind of framing nature. And Robert Irwin was, I know, did a lot of the real pioneering thinking and kind of real site-specific work. And I was just recently at an art museum in Stanford University, and Irwin has one of his disc pieces there. And I had seen them years ago and kind of forgot about them. This thing was so beautiful. I had like kind of mystical experience. If you haven't seen them, there are these like acrylic bowls that are, he painted them or somehow like surfaced them. So they're this beautiful, almost translucent white, and they sit in front of a white wall, suspended in front of the wall. And he lights them in such a way that you can't tell where the artwork ends and the wall begins. It blurs the boundary between the art and the environment. And the whole thing was a beautiful, almost surreal, perceptual moment.
So that's all. That's, yeah, they did everybody. So except, so that's a place called Storm King in New York that has, you know, Calder and Sarah and Irwin and Maya Lin and Goldsworthy, and they're all phenomenal in the landscape. And then there's a kind of much more, a very different question when you move to the city, I think, where you have tighter set of parameters around what makes a public artwork really functional. Is it like someone like Pierre Wiig does amazing work that's temporary in a city, but the memory remains of this extraordinary event. And then there's design solutions like Harry Vittoria's kind of, and there's architecture itself that can really contribute. It's hard to think of, for me, that, you know, like there's a Picasso sculpture in downtown Manhattan, which is this kind of big concrete thing. It's really kind of a B Picasso, and it was done by an atelier after he died, a maquette. But it's amazing, you know, it's an amazing thing. I think when it comes to public art, so often it's a relationship between the site and the object that to distinguish the two, you know, a specific artist is very difficult. There are artists that are killing it, but they're not always able to kill it. So that's the alchemy that you want for that moment where you say, oh, this is not just an amazing piece, but it's amazing because it's here.
Any other questions? Step over here to give you a... I wonder if you're thinking, or if you've been asked to think about the possible redesigning of the intersection that the park is right next to, and that your designs for the park would be able to respond to any changes in the traffic and in that redesign of the intersection.
Well, I'll respond to that first. The scope of the project is the whole intersection, and so that is a possibility for sure to think beyond just the park.
You realize the more you ask of us, the more fundraising letters you're going to get.
So yeah, we're all into, yeah, absolutely do it. Just be prepared to pony up.
Hi. I think Portland would love to have something that people want to come see, and to create a spectacle or have that wow factor, you know, is important. Whether or not it's aesthetically pleasing, that's a, you know, different issue. But Ned, your work was, you know, just blew me away, I have to say. And I was wondering what materials you were thinking of using, because seeing the stainless steel didn't really feel like sort of salt of the earth, pragmatic, sustainable manner, you know. But then seeing your wind lights, Patrick, I mean all of you did amazing jobs, but if you could talk a little bit about the materials and your concern for climate action or sustainability a little bit.
Yeah, well, I've never been attached to a specific material. Every project's been different. Every project's been a unique response to the place and the mood and the ideas that arise and the interactions with the design team. And so yeah, I've used the full spectrum of materials over the years. And yeah, a lot of current projects I'm working on, there's been a lot of interest in using recycled material, or if it's metal, using recycled metal. There's a lot of you know, lead systems and the One Planet kind of rating system where you get, you know, kind of gold stars for, you know, being lighter upon the earth for, you know, how you make things.
Yeah, I'll comment because of the airport and the beetle kill trees as well. And over the years, it's always been a component in my process to see what could be reused. But I think it's also, in my case, and probably everyone else as well, it should be of the site. It should speak of the location somehow that way. And yeah, sometimes that is steel, sometimes that's wood. I was fortunate with the DIA piece that wood was going to work engineering-wise, and actually it was superior to everything else in terms of the engineering with it. I think that's always an opportunity to lessen the impact ecologically, and hopefully it's an opportunity to elevate the art as well.
I think someone in the front had a question. Did anyone else want to tackle
material? Well, I was just going to say, I mean, I also think labor is part of that, and I think, you know, it's interesting is how you employ people and how you, you know, it's nice you work close with fabricators, and for me, almost all my fabrication actually happens in my studio, so we try and keep all of those decisions really close to home.
I should have shown that rock slide. Basically, like Deer Isle granite and native plants was sort of like my first, like keep it local, keep it, you know, build it out of what is here as much as one can. But then there is a kind of self-deception that can occur in that kind of like, well, I'm, as you said, not considering the labor costs or the transportation costs or the number of factors that go into a sort of climate, the climactic impact of an artwork is very complex, but also artworks are such a tiny, tiny thing compared to what is going on every day. Mm-hmm. That, you know, it's a fun conversation to have, because you realize how out of control so many things are that we think are, like, don't use your laptop, you know, like, that's one thing. That's 10% of the world's energy output going right into your cell phones. So, you know, we have to think of, like, it's every layer of this needs to be considered. That's, I think, part of what makes these conversations so great, though, is that we all become a little more aware each time.
I'm an architect, and part of the challenge we face every day is solving pragmatic needs while trying to design beautiful buildings within a budget. And pragmatic needs often consume most of the budget. And I'm interested in how you reconcile a budget with the pursuit of an artistic idea and the execution of it. and when you bump up against the resources, how you respond.
I keep mentioning this, but I feel like those challenges become opportunities. And something unique with all of us is that, at least from what it appears, everyone remains engaged in that process. And I've seen it with other works of art where you distance yourself and all of a sudden those decisions are made by someone else and the art gets lost. To remain engaged in the entire process, to be making it in your studio or whatever, you do get to make those decisions along the way. I think as artists, though, we're fortunate with our process. I understand that of an architect or a designer, that we get to fight for the art. And I think it is a role of the artist to fight for that experience, for the intended sculpture or whatever it is, and not let that go. That's why you commission us.
I think the proposal from the start, actually, that can be built in. For me, personally, this site, the idea that there would be several sites is part of trying to figure out. I think there are a lot of floating factors in this piece. There are a lot of architectural factors, urban planning factors, like they're competing interests. It's not, you know, sometimes you get, here's a wall, it's done, you know. There's a lot of things still up in the air. So for me, the idea that a solution could be really strong that has like a series of components that right up till, you know, that, you know, several years in, you could say, okay, we're actually gonna move that component, or that component has to be reduced in half the size, and it would still actually not you know, affect the actual conceptual idea. Was part of me when I looked at this project, I thought, okay, this is a great solution to this project, will work within a budget that may change because you may, or you know, situations I think in this project will change a lot along the way. And so for me, it was thinking of a solution that could actually, you know, sustain its center through that, and budgetarily too, that if part of it shrunk, it would still be strong.
Yeah, if the proposal is, if you think about it carefully, it becomes part of the DNA of the project. And it gets expressed at every level of the project. And it's much less about trimming it back to suit the budget than more like, you know, you can't really trim back your DNA. Even if you get your arm chopped off, you've still got the same amount of DNA in your body. You know, it becomes part of the message if you get it right, like of the site itself.
So it's hard to turn what I want to express into a question, so I'll just express a very quick aesthetic desire and see if any of you have a reaction to it. And that is, as a winter lover, an ice and snow lover, are there ways, I like the way you each incorporated weather elements or nature elements in some of your works. And what about the notion of incorporating ice and snow, the way snow piles on trees? And I don't know if you've seen Pandora's Lights, but it's so, I mean, the snow and the light. Anyway, I'm looking for a reaction for how you would incorporate a love of winter into a project. So it's more than just that it looks pretty when the snow is on it, but even some way of asking the city to plow the snow a certain way so that it interacts with the art and that kind of thing.
Good luck. It's a great idea. It's great. Yeah, I think Boston had that missed opportunity, you know, when they had that enormous amount of snow. You should have been there and said, this is not a problem. It's a solution. Because it's true for snow, which, you know, snowmen, Santa Claus, it all looks pretty, but also what's it like in pouring rain? Like, what's it like on a really freezing cold April day when you're just sick of winter and the snow's kind of gone and it kind of sucks? It's got to kind of speak to all the seasons. And that's a very complex, you know, leap of imagination, not just the seasons this year, but over many, many years to come. But I think this is actually a really good idea about this, building in this snow retrieval system, where it actually is, maybe trucks from other parts of the city come and dump their snow there too. You create a kind of...
I have just a more general question for Sarah. As the only woman on stage here and also working in the field of public art, which I think is still very male-dominated in comparison to other visual arts practices, has that informed your work at all or motivated you to work in the public sphere more?
I think, you know, it's hard to know. My father was an architect. I studied architecture for a while. Also very male-dominated field. There aren't a lot that aren't male-dominated, but so I think, what's John Mill?
Savitru,
I said it's not true, I was in gymnastics. I think that, you know, it's a difficult question to answer. I think that, I guess the way to answer that is I have two daughters. I would love to see more women role models for them.
I have one question, which is, what do you perceive as the greatest challenges in this project? I think that Matthew approached it a little bit, but so obviously thrills are sort of easy to articulate, but what do you think the challenges will be? I think each of you gets to answer that.
Being a woman, no, just kidding. Just kidding. I think the challenges bringing together, I think the challenges are actually the best part of the project. I think that the project has potential to have a park that does many things at once. And I think there can be an artwork that doesn't just do one thing, but that for me shows up in many places, that is discovered over time in fragments over the space, very specifically, because I think that that place is already used in pockets. That there's a place where that seems more private, there's a place that seems more public, that there, even within a small area, there are many locations of activity. And I think this is more the way people use parks more than ever, is that there are niches where people do different kinds of activities. And when I read the proposal, this idea that there would be food trucks in one area, that there would be a place that would be good for kids in another area, that there would be a place where people would be on the internet or food, that it would have a multidisciplinary, bring this idea of pockets rather than one, you know, moment that everything converges on, was a really exciting part of the proposal. But is also the challenge is that you actually activate it in many levels. You know, that you think about snow, that you think about heat, that it can be flexible. I think that the artwork has to be very flexible in the space.
I think two of the main challenges I've seen, I've been here today, the automobiles, I find that can be very distracting for art and how to not overcome it, but also embrace it. And then as well as the evening experience with the light. There's a very big sign, the Eastland Hotel, which I know is probably iconic for the city, but it's a challenge, and it's a challenge to somehow at least complement that or overcome it. And there's other lights, but how the art can actually be seen as it's intended, dealing with those factors that aren't going to go away. I think those are.
Yeah, and I think a lot of the challenges of the site are things that hopefully the landscape architects will address, you know, kind of the things you guys mentioned, you know, the cars, the you know, kind of really making it feel like a space. And I think it's one of the things that I think is really fortunate about the way you guys have set up this whole thing is that the landscape architects and the artists are coming together at the same time. A lot of public art projects, you don't have that wonderful thing of being able to like rethink this whole plaza. It's like, you know, a very typical public art project would be, we'd be brought in and like, okay, here's this plaza that isn't really working, but maybe a piece of art will save it. And so then, you know, you're trying to like solve all these other problems, and it's often an impossible task. So I think the way you guys have set this whole thing up is great potential for making this place into a real place.
Yeah, and I think just to follow up on Sarah's comments, I think that the kind of making it fully inhabited at every level of participation is key. Also engaging the whole plaza all the way to the museum, which I know is a kind of enigmatic presence, currently sort of distanced from that by the traffic flow. I feel there's a way to make it art sort of aesthetically cohesive. Although the building is you know quite singular, I don't think it's a write-off. I think I'm pretty fond of it. And I think there's a kind of way to extend its geometry into that kind of fragmentation of public uses and actually make it more of a magnet than it is, which is also, you know, it's both the challenge and the reward, is to kind of extend the wildness of the park, this idea of a cultural wildness and fragmentation, and unify it with a kind of sense of social meaning, which at the moment they kind of live in two opposite parts of the square, but I think they could be brought together and kind of connect somehow. That seems to be, which is exactly where that traffic flow happens. That's the kind of the perfect metaphor for like what could, the difficulties and the reward of that. If those things could be brought into proximity, it'd be like, wow, this is a place, like a full place that's cohesive from end to end.
Well, with that, we are out of time. I'd like to thank the PMA for hosting us, CTN for filming us, and I'd like to thank these amazing artists for coming here and presenting their work. We're very fortunate to have such great options to choose from. So thank you for your time. Please fill out your surveys. Leave them at the table up front, please.